church. Happy Mother's Day to all the beautiful moms out there. Let's worship this morning.
See my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night.
I was lost, but he brought me His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Ooh, the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed. While I was
for freedom this morning. Make some noise. Thank you, Lord. We worship you. God, we believe that as we worship, as we get in your presence, you're turning things around for us. You go before us. The battle belongs to the Lord. Amen.
This thing around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around. I'm calling on the name that changes everything. Oh yes, God, turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around. And all of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. Oh, yeah. I'm praying, God, turn this thing around. Oh, no. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. I'm calling on the name that changes everything. Oh, God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. All my hope, all of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough. Turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around. Oh yes, as we worship, God, turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around. Yeah. He is up to something, he is up to something. God is doing something right now. He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something. Say right now. He is healing something. He is saving something.
God is doing something
right now. Yeah. He is healing something. He is saving someone. God is doing something.
Receive it.
Miracles happen when you, and heaven is coming. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
By faith.
God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Come on, lift your voices.
Oh, and God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Speak to your situation today. The presence of the Lord is here. I believe that as we worship, our God begins to move. And when He begins to move, there's healing, there's peace, there's provision, there's salvation, there's hope. All in the presence of the Lord. Worship is powerful. Thank you guys for digging in this morning. You feeling good? Glad you came to church. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it, right? Everybody turn to your neighbor, do a smile check. Make sure your neighbor's smiling. In the balcony, you guys good this morning? Smiling up there. Great to see you. Happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. Can we make some noise for the moms? I called my mom on my way to church this morning. I called my mom. She was up having her coffee. I said, Mom, Have my sisters called yet, or am I the first? She said, you're the first, baby. I said, okay, I love you, Mom. So I got to make sure to text my sisters later and let them know I was the first to call Mom. It's like a funny game we play every year. Did anybody else play that game? Is that just me? Okay, there's a few of you. I see you. Hey, welcome to Covenant Church. If you're here for the first time, you found a great group of people, a great community. If you're watching online, welcome. We're glad you're with us. In honor of Mother's Day, our incredible media team and worship team have put together a really cool presentation to celebrate all that the moms do. Thank you. We love you. Check this out. It's pretty cool.
Yes, I need it done today. It has to be today. Thank you so much. All right, bye-bye.
Wow. How do you do it? Now, being a mom is hard enough, but having a full-time job, too?
Well, we make it work. I mean, I am a mom.
Yeah, you are. What all do you do in a day?
Well, the first thing I do is...
Wake up tight like a mom. Instant oatmeal like a mom. Pop a cute like a mom. Wave it down like a mom. Carpal line like a mom. Second cough like a mom. Spill that cough like a mom. Approve time cards like a mom. Remember birthdays like a mom. Toddler FaceTime like a mom.
Oh, yeah? You went potty? Good job. Okay, bye-bye. Give the phone back.
Zoom me like a mom. Fall asleep like a mom. Pretend you're not like a mom. Sit in traffic like a mom. Take out dinner like a mom. Oh, hi, Deborah. Like a mom. Relearn math like a mom. Check my email like a mom. Showing interest like a mom. Sigh deeply like a mom. Tuck the kids in like a mom. Kiss their forehead like a mom.
So that's pretty much what I do in a normal day, give or take.
That is amazing.
Being a stay-at-home mom is serious, too. What do you do in a day?
Well, I usually...
Up at 5, like a mom. Prep the crock pot, like a mom. Make the coffee, like a mom. Scrambled eggs, like a mom. Custom lunch, like a mom. Make a bottle, like a mom. Send the kids off, like a mom. Forgot the homework, like a mom. Enjoy silence, like a mom. Buying bulk, like a mom.
Now that's a lot.
But we do it because we love them.
The best kids. Oh, time for soccer practice. Kids, let's go!
Same time next week.
Like a mom. Like a mom. Like a mom. Like a mom. Like a mom.
church. That song is going to be stuck in your head all day like a mom. Well, good morning, Covenant Church. Happy Mother's Day to all of our beautiful mothers out there and those of you that are watching online. I personally don't know where I would be without my mother. How many of you are thankful for a praying mom? I know I am. Moms, you are awesome. You're beautiful, you're lovely, you're kind, you're bold, you're awesome, and we celebrate you today. Happy Mother's Day. Look at your neighbor or your child and say, where are you taking me for lunch? All right. Well, we celebrate all of our moms today. And we just want to say thank you so much, Covenant family, for joining us today and worshiping with us today. If this is your first time with us, welcome. Thank you for joining us. Whether you're a first-time guest or this is your 1,000th time here at Covenant Church, we want to connect with you. So on the front of your seat, there is a QR code that you can scan. It will open up a link where we are able to connect with you. We want to be able to pray with you. We want to be able to meet your needs. And there's also a connect card if you want to fill one out in service. You can fill that out. You can list prayer requests and get all the information you need on that card, because we want to be able to connect with you and pray with you and help meet all the needs you have here. Well, summer is right around the corner, and we have some exciting things happening for your student. One of my favorite things that is happening is our Stronger Week VBS. This is just an exciting week full of fun games, some exciting worship, some incredible teaching, and we end the week with big water slides and bounce houses. Your student will not want to miss this. The dates are June 21st through the 25th, and you can find all the information and register for VBS and all of our events on our Cove Live app. Well, speaking of summer, it's coming up, and the end of a school year is coming, and we want to celebrate all of the graduating seniors here at Covenant Church. So if you are a student graduating, we want to celebrate you, whether you're graduating and going off to college, or maybe you're staying here and you're going to sleep on your mom's couch. We want to celebrate you. So make sure you go on the Cove Live app and register so we can celebrate and honor you as a graduating senior. Well, next week, we have a special time of prayer here at our Carrollton campus as we prepare for Pentecost Sunday. Starting May 17th through May 21st, you can join us in person here at the Carrollton campus at 6 a.m. for morning prayer. Listen, if you can't get here at 6 a.m., we will be streaming that, so you can still join us online. Either way, we would love for you to set aside time and just seek God's face for what He has for your life. Well, as we transition into our giving today, we don't necessarily have a ministry update video that shows you all the amazing things that we're doing. However, I want to encourage you, Covenant Church, that your generosity is reaching the world. Covenant has had the opportunity to put seed in good soil all over the world because of you. We say this all the time: when you give, you go. You may not physically be in the place where ministry is happening, but because of your generosity, you are making ministry possible. Because of your faithfulness, you are letting ministry happen. So we just want to say thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness, because you are changing lives, not just here at Covenant, but all over the world. So thank you for your giving. Let me pray for our offering as we give. Let me just tell you how to give real quick. On the seat back in front of you, if you have your phone, you can scan that QR code and it will open a link to your next steps in giving. You can also take an offering envelope if you want to give check or cash, and you can fill that out and drop it in our drop boxes as you exit the service today. And if you're giving online, we just want to say thank you. You can click that Give Now button and it will take you to your next steps in giving. But thank you once again, Covenant, for your generosity and faithfulness. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give. Lord, we give with a cheerful heart. Father, we thank you that you are using us. Lord, as we put this seed into the ground, Father, you are putting it in good soil. Father, we thank you that we can water this seed, Lord, and it is growing. Thank you for using us to minister to those around the world as we give today. Bless the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, in just a moment, we're going to watch a video that highlights one of our small groups. Here at Covenant Church, we believe that real life change happens in relationship. And there is no better place to have relationship than in a small group. And if you've been thinking about joining a small group or maybe even hosting a small group, let me encourage you, stop thinking, be brave, and step out. I promise you, life change will happen in the presence of these relationships and in these small groups. And if you want to get connected to any small group or maybe host a small group, one more time, you can go to our Cove Live app and all the information is on there. If you didn't hear anything I said the Cove Live app has everything that you need to know. Amen? Amen. Well, here in a second, we have the amazing Pastor Sid that is going to come share with us. She has a great word for all of us in Mother's Day. But before that, let's check out this video.
My name is Jennifer Wooten, and I host Arrow Keeper Small Group. As a mom, I wanted to start this group because I know that the attack on our children is strong, and I know that moms are a huge influence in our children. And so just wanted to create a community where that's really the focus, where moms can dig in and just focus on being intentional, because it gets so hard in the everyday, every minute grind of everything. You sometimes get lost in the middle of it all. And a lot of the struggles that moms are going through is their children are home more, which is a beautiful thing because we all want to spend time with our children. But what does that really look like when you're at home and you never get a minute to yourself and you don't know one more activity to do with them? And also there's some that don't have as many people at home. They definitely have a place that they can come and chat and feel connected and feel loved. And I've noticed that just by getting that refresh every single week, I'm able to just be more patient, more loving, more focused on what's really important and not getting caught up in the little things. Because once we get into our small group, we're all moms. And so you can tell when the screen comes on, everyone's like halfway in, halfway out. Little people are still appearing in different screens. But then towards the end, there's complete peace, complete refocus. We're ready to just take on all the challenges. As a mom, I feel like it's really important to have a community of other like-minded moms around you because the culture, there's so many norms that are out there that don't necessarily fit our values, and it's really easy to get distracted or get blindsided on things that are going on. But when you're walking arm in arm with like-minded women, then you're all focused on the same thing. Your eyes are on Jesus, and it's easier to train up your children when your eyes are on him.
I want to invite you to stand and sing one more song with us. We're going to receive the blessing of the Lord today. If you feel comfortable, just hold up your hands.
We receive your promises. His face shine upon you, be gracious.
morning. He is for you. Oh God, we thank you, Lord, that you are for us. We have no reason to be disappointed, to be afraid. Lord, you're here. You hear our prayer. You hear our cry. Whatever we need, if we need encouragement, whatever it is, if we need healing, you are here. Lord, I ask you to walk up and down these aisles and touch every person. Fill them with your presence. Fill them with your power to overflowing, Lord. Right now, in the name of Jesus, come on and let's just praise him and let's thank him that he's here, that he is for us. We don't have to worry about it. Amen. Thank you, God. Well, it's great to see each one of you here this morning. Just greet a few people before you're seated, but hold on, let me say this. What I'd like to do is I'd like our moms, both biological and spiritual, to remain standing, and then everybody else sit down. Okay, all of our moms at every campus, and moms, if you're at home, online, stand up. All right, look at all these moms. Happy Mother's Day to every one of you. And where you're going? Happy Mother's Day. Listen, I don't know about you ladies, but I was exhausted when I watched that video, weren't you? Oh my goodness, thank you. You may be seated, but I would like to ask my beautiful mom to remain standing. I want to take a few minutes and I just want to honor my mother. She's such a lovely person. Mom, I want to thank you and tell you how much I love you, how precious you are to me. Thank you for raising me in the church. I remember as a little girl, you told me that you dedicated me to the Lord when I was still in your womb. And so I've seen evidence of that throughout my life. Thank you. I love you. Now, you did force me to take piano lessons when I was in elementary, but I know it was because her desire was my gift to the house, to the Lord, would be to play for the house of the Lord. So she got her prayer because by junior high school, I was playing for our church. Our little Baptist church, one Sunday a month. It was Young Adult Sunday. I was a young adult choir director, and I played. And then one of my teachers, who was Methodist, his daughter went to college, and she was one of the church pianists for one Sunday of the Methodist church. So he asked my mom, can your daughter play for us one Sunday of the month? And of course, she said, yes. So then I was playing for the Methodist church as well, one Sunday of the month, and I did that until I graduated from high school. So, Mom, I love you. Happy Mother's Day. And then I would also like to take a moment and I would like to honor my mother-in-law, my mother-in-love, Mama Tejada. I love her so much. I'm so grateful to Mama. Thank you for raising this wonderful husband for me and for inviting me in your family as your daughter. I love you. Happy Mother's Day. And last but not least, I have all these thank you guys. I never get up here much, so I got to take it. Advantage of it. I would like to thank my spiritual mom, Pastor Kathy Hayes. And if you've been around Covenant a long time, then she is your spiritual mom as well. And I've told her throughout the years, I said, you know, Pastor Kathy, your wisdom and grace has just been a constant example for me. And you've blessed me in so many ways. And that holds true for today as well in this season of my life. So I love you, Pastor Kathy. Happy Mother's Day to you. And then I would like to thank my husband. Honey, thank you for this opportunity to share today and for not allowing me to back out of it. Yeah. Amen. All right. So I would like to welcome all of the campuses. Carrollton, thank you for being here. Help me welcome Colleyville, Crossroads, McKinney, our online campus. Thank you for joining us today. This is a great day to be alive, and I am so honored to be with you today and to share. I got to get things all ready. See, Jeremy asked me if I wanted his help, and I said, no, it's okay. I got it. Okay, so let's get started. Years ago in my corporate career as a systems design engineer on the F-16 fighter jet, the Air Force asked us to design a situational awareness display to put a God's eye view display for the pilot with reference to threats that he was about to encounter. So this display would let him see his current aircraft position relative to threats he was about to encounter. Now, it also had wingman information and other information as well. And then they wanted us to present this design to the cockpit review team, which consisted of fighter pilots who came from all around the world, and they represent all of the other Air Force fighter pilots that were stationed at bases. And they would come in, I don't know if that made sense, but that's okay. And so we would present the latest and greatest capabilities, and they would vote on all the ones they wanted in the next big software upgrade on the fighter jets out in the field. And so we designed this God's eye view display that they wanted. We put it on what's called the multifunction display set, which is a pair of displays considered heads down. You have the HUD, the head-up display, you have the upfront controls, and then you have the heads down, the multifunction display. Now, the concern with this design was that it would become a distraction for the pilots because they would constantly have to look down to access this information, because you know they want to access this information quite a bit. What if God gave each one of us the ability, real time, as we're walking throughout our lives, to access information about threats we're about to encounter or problems we were about to encounter? Wouldn't we be a little distracted or even obsessed? Come on, obsessed, because we would constantly be looking, okay, what problems do I need to avoid today? Oh my gosh, I'm gonna try to avoid every single problem. I can only speak for myself. I would try to avoid every single problem. There's not one problem that I would say, yes, I can go through that today. But isn't it true that some negative experiences are meant to be a part of our journey in us becoming who God has called us to be? Because it's in the becoming that growth and maturity happens. And Jesus was the only one, 100% God, 100% man. He had full disclosure of threats he was not only going to encounter, but threats that were going to destroy his life. But he didn't look to the left or the right. He didn't try to avoid them. He walked the straight path right to the cross just for you and me. And we are so undeserving. God has uniquely created each one of us for his pleasure. And he has a perspective of what he wants each of our lives to accomplish. And I don't know about you, but I want God's perspective for my life. I want his wisdom and his insight. I don't want to just decide, you know what? I want to do this. I like to do that. I have a gift for this. I think I'll do this. No, I want God. I want your purposes and plans for my life. Lead me and guide me. I want your perspective. Do you feel that way? Well, great. All right. One person feels that way. No. Well, the title of my message today is God's Eye View, the only perspective that really matters. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this message that you've given me today. Lord, I thank you for clarity of thought, clarity of speech, that you would anoint my words, that you would anoint everyone's ears to hear and their hearts to receive what you are saying, because you are the voice of many waters, and you can tailor make whatever I say to be exactly what you need that person to hear. So I thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so the scripture focus for today is found in Matthew 17. You can turn with me there, or you can look at the big Bible in the sky, as we're all, I would say, guilty of doing. But for the moms today, I gave you a bookmark, and I hope you enjoy it. I love tulips, and tulips have such a short season. I wanted you to have tulips all year round. And then some of you may be thinking, that bookmark is so archaic. We read everything on the computer. Well, I want to encourage you to come back to the books where you hold them in your hand. You flip through the pages. I have my Bible next to my bed. I don't have it here, okay? Please forgive me. But I have it next to my bed, and I love having books I can flip through the pages, okay? So Matthew 17, 1-8, let's read. Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered or exclaimed and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles as a memorial, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, They fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and do not be afraid." When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Wow, can you imagine being there to witness this vision? It was incredible. And the Lord gave some advice that day that was timeless because it was true then and it holds true for today. So we're going to get our 3 points from that, but there's a lot right here in this passage that we just read, and I'm going to just pick it apart and we're going to start right at the beginning. It starts with after 6 days. So I want to tell you what was going on just 6 days before. Jesus and the disciples had been on a tour of Caesarea Philippi in Galilee, and the disciples saw Jesus do some amazing things. They saw people getting healed and delivered, and it was incredible. But then he started to have with them what I call crucial conversations. And one of them, Pastor Ricky talked about a few weeks ago, and this one was okay, but it kind of went a little down here from there. But he said, guys, who do men say that I am? And several of them chimed in. Oh, some say John the Baptist. Some say Jeremiah, one of the prophets. Some say Elijah. Then he says, but who do you say that I am? And Jesus, in a profound moment, not Jesus, but Peter, in a profound moment, because he had these moments where he would open mouth and insert foot. But this was profound. He said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said, "Very good, Peter. The only way you know that is because my Father revealed it to you." But then he went on talking about all of these terrible things that were going to happen to him when he went to Jerusalem, and how he was going to be tortured and he was going to be killed. And so the disciples were confused because they had a perspective about why Jesus had come, that he had come, he was coming to set up an earthly kingdom. They had been hearing about the Messiah and they were going to rule with him. But what he was saying didn't make sense to them. And you know they had to be talking among themselves saying, "Does anybody know what he's talking about? I don't know." So they had a perspective of what they thought of why Jesus had come. So let's go on to verse 1, continue. It says this, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain. Now this was our first indication that God was about to elevate their perspective. Because God had used mountains throughout scripture to elevate man's perspective and his understanding. It was on a mountain where God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. It was on a mountain where God gave Moses the instructions to build the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. And then it was on a mountain where he told Elijah to go and meet up on the mountain. So Elijah goes up there, and the scripture says this in 1 Kings 19:11. It says, "And God passed by, and then there was a windstorm, but the Lord was not in the wind. And then there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then there was fire, but the Lord was not in the fire." And then it says, "And Elijah heard a still small voice." So then he came from the back of the cave where he had backed up when all the drama started happening. And it says he came to the mouth of the cave. He wrapped his face in a cloak and he stood before God. And so God began to talk with him. See, God is in the business of elevating our perspective and our understanding, because if he didn't do this, our natural inclination would be to operate in our limited human perspective. And that is not good for anybody in most cases, right? Okay, so let's move on. It says Jesus was transfigured before them in verse 2. So here they are. They are witnessing this vision where heaven is intersecting earth. And Peter had just had the spiritual revelation days before of who Jesus was. But now God is giving them a visual confirmation of who he is, because Jesus' face is shining like the sun, his clothes white like light. You see, God needed these three, Peter, James, and John, he needed them to truly understand who Jesus was because of the upcoming days about what they were about to go through. They were the leaders among the disciples, and he needed them to lead because it was going to get pretty rough. Okay? So here they were seeing Jesus more than just a man. Jesus is, he is who he says he is and who God revealed to us. So then it goes on in verse 3 and it says this, "Moses and Elijah appeared and began talking to him." Now, this is where it went downhill for Peter, because I think he got starstruck. I think he was like, whoa, man, oh, wow, that's amazing with Jesus, but this is Moses, the famous Moses, man. I mean, he didn't say it, but he had to be thinking because of what he did next. This is Moses who God gave the Ten Commandments to. This is Moses who parted the Red Sea. This is Moses who led our people out of bondage. And that's Elijah. He is the one who called down fire from heaven. And God sent chariots of fire, pulled by horses of fire, and took them in a whirlwind into heaven. I mean, he got so caught up in whatever he was thinking that he did the unthinkable. He stepped forward and he spoke, open mouth, insert foot. Jesus, it's so cool that we're here today. If you want, we could build a tabernacle for as a memorial, one for you, one for you, and one for you. All right? And then I love this because look, it says, while he was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. It was like God's like, whoo, I am not going to listen to where he's going with this. And God just interrupted. He said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. God was like, really, Peter? Really, just go with me. I know I'm taking a little license, but all right, it's all in scripture. God's like, really, Peter? I just revealed to you days ago who my son is. I just gave you a visual confirmation today. And here you are in your limited human perspective. You're just trying to make him even with everybody else. No one deserves that place of honor and worship in your life equal to my son, Jesus. And I need you to understand that. So this brings me to our first point, and I asked them to leave it up because I don't have those cute little short points. It's a long sentence, but this is what it is. Don't get distracted with your own perspective and plans, but focus only on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't get distracted with your own perspective and plans, but focus only on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, when we focus on Jesus, when we put him in his rightful place and we ask him to give us his insight, give us understanding, he will not only give us that, but he will give us tailor-made plans just for our situation. Let me tell you, don't you think for one minute that you have a clear understanding of your situation. You can't read people's minds. You don't know what's in their hearts. You don't know their future. You don't know where you fit, where your little life fits into the big scheme of what's going on right now. But we serve a God who knows it all. And he is willing to reveal to us whatever he wants us to see if we ask him. But we have to start by putting him in his rightful place in our lives. God always tries to elevate our understanding and our perspective. Now, here's another example of Peter getting caught in his limited human perspective. Remember I said the crucial conversation, Jesus talking about his death, everything that was going to happen. Well, Peter had the nerve to pull him to the side and chastise him about that. And then Jesus had to turn and put him in his place. Let's read that because I want you to see something. Matthew 16, verse 21 through 23 says this, but Peter took Jesus aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, he said, this will never happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and said, get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap to me. And listen what he said. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Now, let me tell you, we know that Peter did this because he loved him. You guys, oh, poor Peter. Come on, he loved you, Jesus. Why were you so harsh? Well, this is what I want you to understand. Why was the human point of view such a big problem for Jesus in that moment? I believe that Jesus had moments where his humanity tried to take leverage over his divinity. He struggled. You know, while he was telling them about, I'm gonna be beaten, I'm gonna be tortured, I'm gonna be killed, that had to be hard because he was 100% God, he was 100% man. In case you're thinking I'm taking a little too much license, remember in the garden when he prayed and he was sweating and his sweat was like big drops of blood and in agony, he said, God, if there's any way for this cup to pass from me, let it pass. But then he resolved and he said, but nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That showed us there. That wasn't the only time he struggled with it. So in that moment, while he's telling the disciples, guys, we've been on a tour. Things have been great, but we're about to go to Jerusalem, and it's not going to look pretty. I'm trying to prepare you guys. And they were confused, and they didn't understand. So Peter's speaking up in that moment. He was like, he wasn't calling him Satan. He was like, you're allowing Satan to use you to be a stumbling block for me. That's why he said, you're a dangerous trap. Stop. This is not the time. I am telling you, this is the path that I must walk. Now, maybe you're here and you're thinking you're a Peter sympathizer because you're like, you're too hard on Peter. I don't like this. I'm not listening to anything else she's saying because Peter's my favorite disciple and you have just been beating him down. But I want to say something. Peter represents us all and our default position to operate out of our feelings and our pain and our anger, our emotion. He represents all of us, so I can pick on him because when I pick on him, I'm picking on us. And where we always start, God's got to remind us. So don't be distracted with your own perspective and plans, but focus only on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you ever wondered what they were talking about, Jesus, Moses, and Elijah? Well, Luke, in Luke's version of this account, he tells us they were talking about what Jesus was about to go through in Jerusalem. And how his exodus from this world. So maybe they were encouraging him. Maybe they were saying, hey, I know you can do this, Jesus. You can do this. We're with you. But have you ever wondered why it was Moses and Elijah who were chosen to speak to Jesus in this vision? Moses represented the law. Elijah represented the prophets. Didn't the law and the prophets always point to Christ? So in that moment, it was an intersection, the law, the prophets, and the Messiah, whom they had pointed to all along and wanted people to wait for. Okay, let's move on to verse 5. So verse 5, so God moves in. This is my son and whom I'm well pleased. And then he says this, hear him. So this is point number 2. Very straightforward. Let the voice of Christ be the prevailing voice in your life. Listen, there are so many voices in our lives. From the minute we wake up in the morning to we'll go to bed at night, we have family, we have friends, we have our favorite news source, we have newspapers, articles, we have all kinds of things. We have a lot of voices. But I submit to you that we have the big three that every other voice stems from. You might not agree with me, but this is, you're like, big three? Wait a minute. So the first one is this, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now that wasn't the three, that was three in one. That was one voice. And so we hear, God speaks to us through his word when we read it, when we hear the teaching of his word, when he speaks through people, he speaks through circumstances. Hey, there's no limit. He even speaks through a donkey back in the Old Testament. But that's a whole nother story. You can't limit him. He can speak however he wants. But then you have the enemy. You have Satan. Remember Jesus just mentioned how Peter, the enemy was using Satan. The enemy would try to mimic what God does. So he uses people. And sometimes people that we love will say things hurtful. Maybe a mother or a father has said something like, you will never amount to anything. You don't ever get anything right. And you've got to forgive them. Ask God's help to forgive them because they're not meaning to beat you down. But sometimes our limited human perspective, the enemy kind of gets in there and just uses things. So we have to remember this, who God is. Now, this is the third voice, and this is the one I think has the most influence and really the most power over all of us, and it's our own voice. This is why, because we can choose what voice we want to hear. We can choose what we want to believe to be true, but make no mistake that whatever you choose to believe becomes a part of your belief system. And what you believe to be true, you start to act out. You start to speak and act accordingly based upon what you believe to be true. So we have to be careful of what we allow to get in our hearts. Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart above all else because it determines the course of your life, the direction that you're going to go. It takes a lot of effort to guard our hearts. And listen, if you take something that the enemy has spoken through someone, a negative thing that's a lie, and you believe it to be true, you're going to act out on it. You're going to self-sabotage, and you won't even know you're doing it. I had a situation like that. So years ago, one of the most intimidating things I've ever done in my life, besides what I'm doing right now, I've been up since 2 this morning, is was to stand before that room of fighter pilots as the system design lead of the incorporation of three brand new weapons on the fighter jet. I had 80-something charts to present to them, and I talked about all about each one of the weapons, and then I presented to them the design that we created for them to use on the F-16. That was amazing. Oh my gosh, it was terrifying. I did a lot of praying and crying before I got to that point. But then I had to walk forward with such confidence, like I knew what I was here for. But anyway, okay, so anyway, but the path I was on early on in my career as an engineer, the trajectory was not leading me to that moment, that opportunity. So how did I get there? So the first couple of years, I worked hard and I think I did a good job. You know, I was considered a little above average engineer, and my performance appraisal confirmed it, because when I would get my performance appraisal in the middle, I went and looked. I actually still kept my performance appraisal, I was telling. But anyway, I looked at it, and in the center it says needs improvement. To the left it says meets expectations, and all the way to the left it's like exceeds. Well, I was stuck on meets. I just got the job done for several years, and I was like, God, Lord, Lord, I know I can do better. Lord, I just don't know what's going on. I feel like I've hit the ceiling. I just can't get past it. I mean, even in my understanding, because you can imagine how many technical things. It was hard. Every time I went there, I mean, you had to be on your game. Everything was so technical and detail-oriented. And so I was like, God, help me. Help me, Lord. And I remember one of those times I cried out, and I said, God, what's wrong with me? And at that moment, God took me back to an encounter I had the third week after I started working with the company. And there was another girl. She had graduated a few years before me, and she had been working at the company. She had graduated with a mechanical engineering degree, and mine was electrical. And she happened to be a black female, because that's important to the story. So I wait the third week. I go over, and I'm so excited to see a familiar face from school. And I give her a hug, and one of the first words out of her mouth, or the first words were, "Sid, black people won't get anywhere in this company." And it was like a slap in the face, but I just listened, and I walked away, and I didn't talk to anybody about the conversation. I didn't think that I was meditating on it at all, but the Holy Spirit said to me when he took me back to that encounter, and when I remember what she said, he said, "You believed her over me." And I was like, oh my gosh, God, I didn't even think I even remembered that encounter. But then I realized that because I believed, I took to heart what she said, and I believed no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get past a certain point. And so I said, God, forgive me. I was self-sabotaging, and I didn't even know it. And so I don't know what limiting words have been spoken over you, or what limiting thoughts you've been operating under, and you feel stuck and you can't break through. And I'm asking you right now to allow Jesus' voice to be the prevailing voice in your life. You need to ask God to give you his perspective about your situation. If you can't break through, say, God, I feel stuck. Show me, is there something I'm not seeing in this picture? Help me to see it. And I promise you, he will show you. I would have had no clue if I hadn't wanted to get exceeds. It might sound selfish, but I wanted to give my very best. I wanted exceeds. I didn't want to just meet expectations. And so I'm going to tell you, okay, I just started in that moment. I said, God, forgive me. I thank you. I know that I can do all things through you who gives me the strength. I know that I'm your daughter, and I know no weapons formed against me will prosper. I mean, I just started using the word, and I was encouraging myself and the Lord like David did when his mighty men turned on him for a little bit. So we have to do that. We have to remind ourselves who we are. I'm a son of the living God. I'm a daughter of the living God. We tell our sons all the time. We tell them, I said, don't forget who you are. Remember who you are. And I'm talking about the son of the living God. Let me say this. We should never focus on the things that appear to put us at a disadvantage, because we will never reach our maximum potential. Never, ever. Don't you focus on whatever you think puts you at a disadvantage. Maybe somebody told you, you're too big, you're too small, you're too tall, you're too short, you're too whatever. You're not smart enough, you're too smart. I don't know what it is. You're of the right pedigree. I don't know what you've been told, but you have got to rise above it. Stinking thinking helps you walk out a self-fulfilling prophecy. You begin to sabotage yourself without realizing it, like I was. But doing the opposite, meditating on the promises of God, declaring His word, it helps us to walk out our God-given prophetic purpose. So you get some scriptures for you to stand on and start declaring them and see what God's going to do in your life. Because the end of the story, because I don't want to forget this, as you know, I got to have that opportunity, but things changed for me. It turned around, but it started here and here. And when I realized who I was and I could do whatever God empowered me to do. And then I got the opportunity. We heard, the design engineers heard about these brand new weapons. And I got, long story short, I'll have to tell you the details another time, but I got the opportunity to do it. And guess what? My performance appraisal was exceeds after that for the work I did on it. And it stayed on exceeds till I left the company. I have a copy of that too. And then also, I received a letter from the Air Force, a letter of appreciation. And actually, they mentioned 5 engineers, but then another paragraph said, we'd like to especially thank Ms. Sid Patton. So the other guys were all excited about the letter, but then they're like, oh, that's your letter. And so my boss was so proud, he put it in a company newspaper. I hope I'm not sounding like I'm bragging. I just want you to see how God can turn things around. And then I received a raise and a promotion. This is my story, only I can tell. And so I want to share it with you to encourage you for wherever you are. So let's move on to verse 6. That was point number 2. Let Jesus' voice be the prevailing voice in your life. Okay, so verse 6. Remember we said, but suddenly God came in that cloud, right? So he spoke, and then it says, but when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and they were greatly afraid. Now listen, I'm not picking on Peter or nobody, because if we were all there and that happened to us, where we're looking at this wonderful vision and then all of a sudden a cloud, we're surrounded by this bright cloud and a voice booms, we would have all fallen flat on our faces. But here's the thing, is that fear is our first response when the suddenlies come in our lives, or when things we don't understand happen, or the unknown happens. Fear is our first response, but that's not the problem. The problem is when fear remains. Verse 7 says this, but Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. Now, in that moment, I know you're saying, well, he was just talking to them by getting up right then. But no, he was speaking to something much deeper in them. Because of all the things he was saying about what was going to happen to him, you know they had to wonder if they were following them, what's going to happen to us? And then Jesus went on and he would say, and if you're going to follow after me, you need to take up your cross and follow me. And whoever tries to save your life will lose it. You know the guys had been talking among themselves. What is he talking about? We didn't sign up for this, man. But we're with you, Jesus. But you know they were afraid. And they were like, but God, we're with you. But they're like, does he mean literal? Does he mean figuratively? What is he talking about? They still didn't really, really understand. So Jesus was saying to them, when he touched them, he was like, listen, you three, you're the leaders among my disciples. You're going to have to arise and not be afraid. I need you to lead the rest of them because things are going to happen. It's going to be hot and heavy, and it's going to be hard. So verse 8 says, when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. So point number 3 is this. We must fix our eyes on Jesus only and choose to arise out of the place of fear and doubt. When they saw Jesus only, it gave them the strength to stand. Because if fear remains, fear of what others think, fear about the future, fear of whatever, what we've allowed ourselves to believe about ourselves, you know what it does? Fear paralyzes. It paralyzes us, but not just that, it blinds us to truth. Because all we can see is the lie that we've been believing. So when fear remains, it can lead to discouragement, severe discouragement and depression. It can lead to hopelessness and despair. It can lead to us being stuck in the old limiting mindsets, living life through our anger and our fears and our offenses and whatever. We could be stuck in our self-devised plans and strategies if fear remains. But remember what verse 8 says. When they looked up, they saw no one
but Jesus. So they arose from their place of fear. So I'm asking you today to look up from your place of fear and doubt. Trust that God has got you. He's gonna lead you. He's gonna guide you. He's gonna take care of you. I promise you. But then look up from your place of depression. Find somebody else who is worse off than you and go and serve and help someone else. Get the focus from you only. I want you to look up from your place of being stuck in the limiting mindsets. Don't be stuck. Look up. See no one but Jesus only. Fix your eyes on him. Then you will have the strength to arise. Whatever your situation is, listen. The odds seem to be stacked against you. Maybe it's in your family life, your professional life, your personal life. I don't know what it is. Or maybe you've received a medical diagnosis that seems insurmountable. There's nothing too big for him. And we're going to fight for the truth of what God wants us to see. And these 3 points I just gave you, we got to fight for those every single day. Sometimes, depending upon your makeup, several times a day. Number one, don't get distracted with your own perspective and plans, but focus only on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then he will give us his wisdom, his insight. He will give us solution for our problem. He will give us tailor-made plans, like we said, just for our situations. You would have never gotten that on your own. Number two, let the voice of Christ be the prevailing voice in your life. And number three, we must fix our eyes on Jesus only and choose to arise out of the place of fear and doubt. These are the choices we have to make every single day. Excuse me. If we purpose in our hearts to please Jesus in everything we do, then we will do everything with excellence. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto us. When we focus on acknowledging who he really is, then we discover who we are and who we are supposed to be. Because Jesus rose out of that grave, guess what? We can arise out of grave mentality, grave understanding, grave living, grave perspective. We need to ask God about this race situation and what's going on and all this fighting that's going on. We need to get his perspective. Stop operating out of your anger and your frustration and whatever it is. Listen, life is hard enough. We need to help each other stand. We need to link arms together and fight together. We need to encourage one another. We don't have time for all of that crazy stuff. And we as the sons and daughters of God, we have to live differently. We don't have to be like the world. Across the world, the body of Christ needs to link arms and stand. Are you willing to stand? Yes, you can stand with me today. We're trusting God for who he is and what he's doing. When we allow Jesus to elevate our perspective and understanding, then we are allowing him to elevate us. God's eye view is the only perspective that really matters. Let's pray. Come on. Thank you, Lord. Oh, God, we thank you this morning. Father, you gave me this message. When you led me to the scripture at first, I had no clue. I didn't see anything there. But, Lord, you knew what you wanted to say today. And I thank you that you're doing surgery in the hearts and minds of your people. And, Lord, for anybody that feels stuck, that feels discouraged, Lord, because they've been operating in the limited human mindsets, I thank you that you would set them free right now in the name of Jesus, that you would reveal the thing that caused them to be stuck. I thank you for liberty for every person here in the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father. Amen. Now, if you would keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want to speak to some of you here today, because maybe as I was speaking, you were here and you said, you know, I don't feel like I can honestly say that I'm a son or a daughter of the living God. I don't feel like I have that kind of relationship with him. And if you're here today, then the Holy Spirit, you feel a little like I need to act out on this. Then I want to ask you to lift your hand. Or maybe you might be that person that you're saying, I have accepted Jesus, but I know that the way I've lived my life, I have not made the best decisions. And if people looked at me, they would think that I wasn't a son or daughter of the living God. So you're here today. Don't pass up the opportunity to lift up your hand and say, Jesus, I want to accept you as Lord and Savior of my life. Is there anyone here today? I see hands. Come on, raise up your hand if you're here today and you say, I want to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life. You're here and you say, I want to return back to Christ. I see this hand. Do we have any more hands? Also, at the other campuses, if you're there, lift up your hand. And also online, there's a little button that says, I'm lifting up my hands. Right now, don't pass this opportunity because Jesus said, if you be ashamed of me before men, I will be ashamed of you before my Father who's in heaven. Do you know that tomorrow is not promised to any of us? So we have to take every opportunity that we have. Let me see your hands raised high all over this place. Those who want to accept Jesus as Lord, amen. I see your hands back there. Thank you, Lord. At every campus, raise your hands. Thank you, Father. Well, this is what I want to do. I want to take it a step further. And I want to say to you, I remember the time when I raised up my hand to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life. I grew up in the church, but I didn't really get saved till I was a freshman in college. And so I remember that day. So I want to ask you, you've raised your hand. I want to ask you to not be shy. Our team is going to sing for a little bit. I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat and come on here and walk down to the altar. Maybe you didn't even raise your hand, but you know you're supposed to come. I promise you, as you begin to walk, you will start to feel liberated. As I walked down that aisle, at first I was kind of afraid, but when I took a few steps, I felt liberated. Yes, this is my moment. This is my time. I'm not going to pass it up. So I want to invite you to step out of your seats and come down to the altar today as we sing. Thank you.
Yes, I am. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free.
Congratulations to each one of you. Which one of you? God bless you. Thank you so much for responding to God's call today. We prayed for you before this day. We prayed for you. This is your appointed time. There's nothing more important than you could have done today. And I want to ask you to just repeat after me, because the scripture says, if you believe in your heart and confess the Lord Jesus and believe that he raised Christ from the dead, you're saved. It's as simple as that. So I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with me and all of you as well. Dear Jesus, I love you so much. I need you, Lord. Thank you for this moment. Please cleanse me of all sin and unrighteousness. Please forgive me for everything that I've done, Lord. I surrender to you right now. I give my heart and my life to you. Have your way in me. Jesus, I believe who you are. I know you gave your life for me. And you rose from the dead for me. And I'm grateful. In Jesus' name, let everyone say amen. Congratulations. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so much. Now, we have some team members right behind you. And if it's okay, we actually have a little gift, a Bible for you, if you would like it, an easy-to-read Bible. And we just want to get some information because we have info we want to give you to help you on this new walk that you have decided on. We want to come alongside you as your sisters and brothers in God. So thank you for responding to this call. Go and tell someone else that you made this decision today. Go and let the world know because you let us all hear. This is your great big family. So God bless each one of you. We love you and thank you. Crazy. Thank you. Oh, our team's right here to the left. Okay. To your left and my right. Thank you. Amen. What else do I do? Okay. I'm going to turn this over. I did my part. I'm passing it to you. Thank you.
That was awesome. And listen, if you made that decision and you didn't make your way down, we want to take this opportunity to still walk alongside of you. So you can text these words, I am saved, to the number 41411, and we will get some material in your hand to walk you along that decision that you made as well. If you did not make your way down, you can also do that online. Let me bless you out of here, and make sure you take your mom to lunch. Make sure you celebrate your mom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may he cover you with his name, Jesus. Be blessed. We'll see you next week.